Everyone might say that Christmas Day is December 25th, but for super cool people like you and I, it's actually whatever date the Royal Rumble lands on. So like January 20-something? It may be a month after Santa and his sexy little elves have visited, and we're all still trying to work off that turkey and chocolate, but come Rumble Eve, we are usually giddy with excitement. Typically a night of shocks, surprises, and once-in-a-lifetime moments, the Rumble has managed to retain its place as one of WWE's premier pay-per-views and match types over the past 30-plus years by keeping fans guessing right up until the buzzer hits. Honk! With 30 warm bodies required and a portion of the roster either being unavailable or required elsewhere on the card, WWE have in the past turned to unexpected and often unadvertised names to bolster the ranks. These usually take the form of a beloved legend from the past or a returning hero, but the key word here is usually, because sometimes WWE enlist the services of performers nobody remembers, people that the audience have never seen before, or sometimes people who aren't even bloody wrestlers in the first place. There have been hundreds of Rumble participants all told, but the following have lingered on in the memory because of how incredibly out of place they were. I'm Adam Pacitti from Cultaholic Wrestling, and these are the 10 strangest Royal Rumble entrants ever. Join us. Number 10, Doug Gilbert. The 1996 Royal Rumble match showed that WWE's roster not only lacked depth, but was populated with some truly awful gimmicks. When the field of entrants includes Isaac Yankem DDS, Duke the Dumpster Drosy, Make a Difference Fatu, Sparky Plug, Karma, and Portuguese Man-O-War Aldo Montoya, you know you're in trouble. The pickings were slim, and outside of Shawn Michaels, Vader, and the British Bulldog, there weren't any viable winners. WWE's roster was so threadbare at this point that they had to look further afield in order to pad out the 30. This included a random cameo from Doug Gilbert, brother of the late great Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert, who won a battle royal in WWE Feeder League Memphis's USWA territory to gain entry. It's fair to say that nobody knew who the bloke entering at number 19 was. He entered to some generic bluegrass music and looked completely ordinary for the time he was in the match, which was just shy of 3 minutes before he was eliminated by Vader. And Christ almighty, don't even get me started on whatever that haircut was. A completely pointless and rather bizarre entrance, this was Doug Gilbert's sole WWE appearance. Number 9, Ernest Miller. I'll forgive you for either forgetting or simply not knowing about Ernest the Cat Miller's unexceptional spell in WWE. Miller was an unlikely star for WCW, getting his opportunity because he was, of all things, the karate instructor of Eric Bischoff's kids. My word, that is some sweet, sweet nepotism right there. Miller's WCW run was largely undistinguished, but he did get to appear with his idol, soul singer James Brown, on a pay-per-view, which is nice. After sitting out the remainder of his Time Warner guaranteed contract, Miller signed with WWE and became a commentator for the weekend show Velocity, which hardly anyone watched, and then became a wrestler again and was given his own sidekick named Lamont. If you remember anything about his WWE run, it's more than likely his brief appearance at the 2004 Royal Rumble, where he and Lamont were quickly eliminated by Randy Orton and Chris Benoit while dancing to their entrance music. It was a bit of harmless comedy, yes, but I'm sure there were 10 or 20 other guys on the roster who could have actually done something worthwhile with the spot and enjoyed the payday. Further hammering home what a wasted entry this was, Miller was released just weeks later. Number 8, the AAA Luchadors. The 1997 Royal Rumble was one of the biggest ever, taking place in front of over 60,000 people at the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas. The pay-per-view was all about one thing, the redemption of local hero Shawn Michaels, who went up against Psycho Sid in the WWE title headliner. On the undercard, WWE took advantage of their working relationship with AAA and drafted in a gaggle of luchadors to work some prelim matches, as well as the Rumble itself, no doubt in an effort to appeal to the large Hispanic contingent in the audience. Selected for Rumble duty were Latin Lover, Cybernetico, Pierre Roth, and genuine legend Mil Máscaras. A cultural icon south of the border, Máscaras was also legendary for his backstage politicking, and so it came as little surprise when he chose to eliminate himself with a top rope dive to the outside of the ring rather than be eliminated by anyone else. Truth is, fans didn't really care about the AAA involvement, as none of them, besides Máscaras, were established names, and it hadn't been featured on WWE TV before. They were there to make up the numbers, and, in Latin Lover's case, look quite handsome. The AAA-WWE relationship ended soon after, though Mascaras was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 2012. Number 7, Dick Murdoch. Dick Murdoch was a wrestling legend and had enjoyed a long and varied career when he showed up randomly as an entrant in the 1995 Royal Rumble match, 10 years after last wrestling for WWE. Captain Redneck was a star in Japan and the Southern Territories, famed for his Texas Outlaws tag team with Dusty Rhodes, as well as his partnership with the Junkyard Dog and feud with the Fabulous Freebirds. A hard-nosed brawler whose wrestling was as pretty as his face, Murdoch captured WWE tag title gold when teaming with Adrian Adonis as the North-South Connection in the mid-80s. Dirty Dick showing up for the first time in a decade sure was odd, and he looked like something from a bygone era as he trudged around throwing bombs and doing the old airplane spin on Henry O. Godwin. He lasted just over 5 minutes before he was slung over the top by the Hog Farmer, never to be seen again. At this point, you might be expecting me to tell you how he tragically passed away just over a year later at the age of 49, but enough people have come forward with stories about him possibly being a card-carrying member of the KKK, so I'll just end this section by saying that I always preferred Trevor Murdoch anyway. Number 6, Tom Brandy. The 1998 Royal Rumble was one that, realistically, only one man was ever going to win. This was the night for the red-hot, stone-cold Steve Austin to triumph, setting up the journey to his first WrestleMania main event and WWE title win. To be honest, the other 29 might as well not have shown up, but that would make for a pretty boring pay-per-view, wouldn't it? Just watching Austin celebrating his automatic victory by drinking beer for an hour. Actually, that sounds really bloody entertaining, and I would happily sit through it, but what we actually got wasn't too bad either. Because we got The Rock putting in a mammoth shift, all three faces of Foley showing up, Terry Funk with a chainsaw, and a stunning performance by Tom Brandy. Alright, that last bit was a lie. Tom Brandy was in the match, entering at number 3, but he was also out of it within 12 seconds. Which leads me to my next question. Who the hell was Tom Brandy? Oh right, it was Salvatore Sincere. Which leads me to my next question. Who the hell was Salvatore Sincere? I don't really know who either of these people are or what they were doing in the Rumble, but I've upset myself now, so I think it's time that we swiftly move on. Number 5, Jonathan Coachman. Oh, we're moving on to Jonathan Coachman, are we? The coach, brilliant. As the coach turned from bland babyface announcer to punchable sidekick of Eric Bischoff, he began getting more and more involved in the in-ring action, including having matches with fellow commentators Jerry Lawler and Jim Ross. All classics, I can assure you. He tried his luck in the 2005 Royal Rumble, entering at number 21, though he didn't do much of note, mainly sticking to hitting other entrants before running away. A winning strategy, I'm sure you'll agree. He actually managed to last a respectable 14 minutes, give or take, before being dumped out by Ric Flair. He was back the following year, beating the King in a qualifying match to gain entry and coming in at lucky number 7. Unluckily for him, though, he was met by the Big Show and chunked within 30 seconds. The whole coach as a wrestler experiment was certainly odd, and it's strange watching him in these rumbles looking back. Number 4, Genichiro Tenryu and Takao Mori. Shinsuke Nakamura and Asuka winning the two Royal Rumble matches in 2018 was a nice surprise, wasn't it? Prior to their dual victory, a Japanese superstar outlasting the rest was but a pipe dream. Your Tajiris, Takami Shinoku's, and Tenryu's didn't stand a chance. And now you're probably thinking, who's Tenryu, aren't you, you Philistines? Genichiro Tenryu is a legend in Japan, but relatively unknown elsewhere. Longtime WWE fans will remember him for his appearances at WrestleMania 7 and in the 1993 and 94 Royal Rumbles, which came about due to a working relationship between Vince's company and Tenryu's Super World of Sports outfit. He entered at number 9 in 93 and lasted 13 minutes before getting eliminated by The Undertaker. In 94, he managed to make it to the final five, coming in at number 24 and hanging around for 17 minutes before co-winners Bret Hart and Lex Luger hoied him over the top. Tenryu, along with the Great Kabuki, were entered into the match by Mr. Fuji in a bid to hinder Luger and prevent him from winning and facing Yokozuna at WrestleMania. They also helped Yoko beat Taker in his WWE title match earlier in the show, as well as attacking Mr. USA say backstage. Takao Amori was another arbitrary entry from the Far East, showing up in 1996 at number 11 and doing much of nothing for a few minutes before being sayonara'd by Jake Roberts and Triple H. Number 3, Carlos Colon. A wrestling deity in his native Puerto Rico, Carlos Colon was essentially an unknown in the United States and especially to WWE audiences. On the Island of Enchantment, Colon participated in countless bloody and brutal brawls, earning one of those foreheads that looks like it lost a fight with Freddy Krueger's glove. Carlito and Primo's dad had actually worked for Vince McMahon Sr. and the Worldwide Wrestling Federation in the late 1960s before he forged his reputation as a bleeder. His one-night-only return came as a participant in the 1993 Royal Rumble match. He entered at number 24 and lasted a respectable 7.5 minutes, during which time he managed to 86 Damian Demento. He was eventually eliminated by winner Yokozuna, but the most amazing thing about Colon's appearance was Gorilla Monsoon saying there was a lot of fire in this youngster as the 44-year-old made his entrance. Monsoon, a former business associate of Colon, had his tongue planted firmly in his cheek, of course, but it must have sounded ridiculous to the millions of fans watching the match unaware. Colon's appearance in the Rumble, devoid of context, was a head-scratcher, but he was a genuine legend and rightfully took his place in the WWE Hall of Fame class of 2014. Number 2, Drew Carey. Speaking of WWE Hall of Famers, let's talk about Drew Carey for a bit, shall we? The star of The Drew Carey Show, of course, and one-time host of The Price is Right, the man is no Bob Barker, let me tell you, Carey entered the 2001 Royal Rumble not to win a shot at the WWE Championship in the main event of WrestleMania, but to promote his upcoming Improv All-Stars pay-per-view. Drew showed up at the event and, after hitting on Trish Stratus, was convinced by Vince McMahon to enter the Big Battle Royal. Entering at number 5, Carey watched the Hardys eliminate themselves before Kane came out at number 6. Uh-oh. Earlier in the night, Carey had referred to the Big Red Machine as that goofy guy in a mask, setting up this epic in-ring confrontation. Sadly, we didn't get to see Kane tombstone the glasses off his annoying little face as, following a vain attempt at bribery, Raven came out to save his backside and Drew simply eliminated himself. It's at this point I would like to stress once again that Drew Carey is an official member of the WWE Hall of Fame, while Elizabeth, Vader, and the Steiners are not. Number 1, The Headhunters. With Vince McMahon and WWE Creative craving surprises for the 1996 Rumble, Mick Foley suggested a tag team that he had previously worked with in Japan. The Headhunters was certainly a unique act. Less than 6 feet tall but weighing 350 pounds apiece, the face-painted bruisers made up for a lack of technical ability or finesse with a penchant for putting their bodies through hell and an awe-inspiring agility not seen in many men of their size. They were successful in Mexico, Japan, Puerto Rico, and on the Indies, but that success did not translate to WWE. Renamed the SWAT team, they entered the Rumble at number 15 and 16, and were duly dispatched of with ease by fellow monsters Vader and Yokozuna. The duo lasted a combined 90 seconds, and impressive as they were to look at, they didn't get to show a single thing that made them such an in-demand team around the world. In what was possibly the weirdest Rumble ever as far as the lineup goes, they stick out as the oddest of odd entrants. Flash forward a year and a half and they got another bite at the WWE cherry, appearing as the Arabian Butchers and getting involved with the Headbangers and Owen Hart and Davey Boy Smith on Raw before disappearing once again.